Good evening, students. As we were continuing with the second lesson of history and from trade to territory, we have covered two topics of this chapter. And in our previous topic, when we were covering the topic East India Company East, East India Company comes east. Under that, we came to know about the East India Company, and we knew that the East India Company, it secured the right to trade with the eastern countries through a charter in the year 1600 AD. Okay, what was the East India Company? The East India Company was basically a company formed by a group of merchants under the head merchants adventurer. Okay, in the year 1599 AD. Okay, and we know that through the charter that was authorized by Queen Elizabeth I, the East India Company got the sole right to trade with the eastern countries. And what we saw when we were covering the topic, we saw that there were a number of companies in the field of trade as far as the eastern countries were concerned, and the East India Company, okay, was basically a mercantile company. And what do we mean by the word mercantile? The word mercantile means a business enterprise. Okay, the word mercantile means a business enterprise that tries to earn profit by excluding competition. And how can we exclude competition? We can exclude competition when we are able to gain a monopoly on the market by driving our rivals, okay, the rival trading companies out of the market scenario. We can gain a monopoly over the market, and this is how the East India Company was successful in gaining a monopoly in trade in India. Okay, and it was possible because of the supreme naval power the East India Company had. We saw that the urge to secure trade markets in the eastern countries, led to fierce battles among these rival groups. Which were the rival groups? Okay, we see that among the European powers, among the European powers that struggled to gain control over trade in India, okay, where the Dutch, okay, the Portuguese, we see the Dutch were there, the Portuguese were there, the French, and the British, okay. Okay, so we see that these were the European powers that were struggling among themselves to gain control over the trade market of India, and the goods that were traded from these countries included, we know that the trading companies, they traded in the goods like cotton, the fine cotton that we had, chint, cochias, okay, bandana, these were the types of cotton that were produced in the subcontinent, and they traded in these fine qualities of cotton, then fine silk and the spices. Apart from this, saltpeter, salt, okay, and a number of goods like tea, okay. all these were the goods that they were interested in, okay, doing trade with our continent. So we see that by the end of the 17th century and the early 18th century, what they did, they regularly sank each other's ships. Okay, the ships were loaded with goods to be exported to Europe. So what they did, in order to gain a control over the market, okay, they regularly sank each other's ships, they blockaded the sea routes, and they tried to gain control over the sea waters. And we see that it was finally the British who were successful in gaining control over the trade market of the country. Okay, if we look at the lower part of the subcontinent, the Carnatic region, you will see that there was a rivalry among the French and the English. Of all the superpowers, it were the French who gave a stiff competition to the British as far as trade was concerned. And we see that a continuous war was fought, a continuous Anglo-French rivalry existed among the British and the French, and these wars they lasted for nearly 40 years, the Anglo-French rivalry. We see that the French gave a stiff competition to the British in the field of trade. And we see, as far as the political position was concerned, it were the French who were giving a stiff competition to the British. And we see that the French and the English, they clashed with each other. They clashed with each other on the grounds of trade, and three Carnatic Wars were fought between the French and the British to gain control. Why these wars were fought? These wars were fought to gain control over the Carnatic region. Control over the Carnatic region. This Carnatic region was famous for the cultivation of spices like cardamom, and pepper. We see that the Carnatic region was famous for the cultivation of the spices like cardamom and pepper, and it was also famous for the for sandalwood. So we see that the rulers of these areas, they were not interested in allowing these invaders, they were not interested in allowing these foreign trading companies to have a control over this region. And we see that to some extent the rulers, they supported the French, and the Britishers, they did not want any kind of interference in the field of trade as far as this region was concerned. So three Carnatic wars were fought between the French and the British, and these wars, the wars lasted for nearly the Carnatic region is, it is the region present day, state of Tamil Nadu. The region covered by the state of Tamil Nadu can be considered as the Carnatic region. And the wars, the Carnatic wars lasted for nearly 40 years. We see these wars, they lasted for 40 years. Okay, the British were able to subdue the French both in India as well as Europe. Okay, and they proved themselves to be superior as far as the field of trade was concerned and as far as diplomatic relations were concerned with the Indian rulers. So we see that the defeat of the French in the Carnatic Wars paved the way for the establishment of British Empire, okay, in India. Now when we go through the state of Bengal, we see that we know that because of the decline of the Mughal Empire in the 17th century, we see that many powerful regional kingdoms, okay, with the decline of the Mughal Empire, in the 17th century, okay, many powerful regional kingdoms claimed themselves independent of Mughal authority. And among these regional kingdoms, we have studied in our last class, the four important regional kingdoms were that of Awadh, Bengal, Hyderabad and Jaipur. Okay, so we see among the regional kingdoms that claimed themselves, okay, that claimed themselves independent of Mughal authority were the kingdoms of Awadh, Bengal, Hyderabad and Jaipur. Okay, now we are going to study about the state of Bengal or the kingdom of Bengal. Now see what happens in Bengal. Okay, we see that from the early 17th century, many superpowers are having a struggle, are in continuous clash with each other to gain control over the trade market in the East, that is India. And among the different powers, we see that it was Holland, okay, Portugal, England, Denmark and France. Okay, from the 17th century, trading companies like from Portugal, Holland, Denmark, France, okay, and England began to set up their trading centers. All these companies, they were interested in trade. We see that it is only the British who are gaining the sole authority, the sole right to trade with the East by signing the charter in the year 1600. But these powers, okay, followed the British, and they also saw that there was profit in the field of trade, okay. So they followed the British and they also started setting up their trading centers in different parts of the country. okay, in different parts of the country, especially the coastal areas. The coastal regions were important because these coastal regions had numerous ports, trading ports through which the goods could be easily transported. The goods could be easily imported and exported, okay, in and out of the country. So we see that the trading ports were mainly located in the coastal regions, and these coastal regions had an important place in the field of trade for these trading center companies. So we see that these trading centers, okay, which were established in the coastal regions, these centers, okay, were called factories. So we see that these trading centers, they were called factories. Now what was a factory? Okay, a factory was a place, a factory was a warehouse, a factory was a warehouse where goods for trade were stored and, okay, company officials were stationed. Okay, when you go through your book, you will see that the company officials, they were known as the factors. Okay, the company officials were known as the factors. So we see that the trading centers were set up by the trading companies in different parts of the country, especially the coastal, especially in the coastal regions, and these centers were called factories. Okay, what was a factory? A factory was a warehouse where goods for trade, okay, it was not a place where goods were manufactured. Okay, normally we think that the factories are the place where goods are manufactured, but here a factory was a warehouse where goods for trade were stored and company officials were stationed. Okay, when we move further in the lesson, we will see that most of these factories also had the houses of officials. Most of these factories, most of these factories had houses of officials and residential quarters for merchants and traders. Okay, so we see over time some factories were fortified, and with passage of time we see that over time some of these factories were fortified. Okay, now you must be imagining that the East India Company was a trading company and it has come to trade with trade in our country. Okay, and how come that they are establishing factories, and how come they are fortifying these factories? It did not happen in one day. See how it happened. Okay, they were true diplomats. We see that there was political instability. There was political instability in the 17th century because many regional powerful kingdoms, they have claimed themselves independent of the Mughal authority, and the Mughal empire had declined with the death of Aurangzeb. And after Aurangzeb, no competent ruler could succeed him, okay, could succeed the Mughal empire. So we see that the British, they did not gain the control of the subcontinent within one day. Okay, it happened with passage of time, and we see that it was during the time of the Mughal emperor Shahjahan. Okay, we see that the Mughal emperor Shahjahan, okay, issued a royal firman in the year 1634, okay, and gave trading rights to the British. Okay, so this was the first step the British took, okay, in establishing itself as a powerful trading company. It was the first step. It got a royal firman. It was able to receive a royal firman from the Mughal emperor Shahjahan in the year 1634, which gave the British the sole trading rights within the country. Okay, and with this trading right that they received in the year 1634, they set up their factories at Kasim Bazar and Patna. These were the two places where they set up their factories. Okay, the British were able to set up their factories at Kasim Bazar and Patna. Okay, and again we see that in the year 1698, the company bribed Mughal officials and got the Jamindari rights over the three villages. In the year 1698, the British, okay, they were able to bribe the Mughal officers officials, okay, and get the got the Jamindari rights Yes, children, can you view the lower part of the board? The lower part is visible? Ah, beta?
No, ma'am.
It is not visible?
No, ma'am.
Okay, let me write it over.
No, ma'am.
Okay. You should raise your hand if you are not
No, able, ma'am.
If you are not able to understand, okay? Raise your hand so that I am able to understand what is your problem. We see that in the year in the year 1698. Okay, the company bribed the Mughal officials and got the zamindari right, and they got the zamindari right over 3 villages. They got the zamindari right of 3 villages of Bengal. So see how they are coming as traders, and they are taking the help of the corrupt officials of our kingdoms, the ruling kingdoms, and with the help of these corrupt officials they are slowly and gradually establishing themselves as trading powers. 3 villages of Bengal, and which were these 3 villages? The 3 villages were Sutanati, Kalikatta, which later came to be known as Calcutta, and the third one was Gobindpur. So these are the 3 villages. These are the 3 villages of Bengal, and the British are able to secure the zamindari right of these 3 villages of Bengal. Again, as we go through the books, we come to see that the first, we see that after Aurangzeb's death, the British even persuaded the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, to grant the company Farman to have right to trade duty free. They did not want to pay any duty charges. Right to trade duty free. So we see that they were able to persuade the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, also known as Alamgir, to grant the company Farman to have right to trade duty free. And we see that after Aurangzeb's death, we know Aurangzeb died in the year 1707 AD. We know this. And with the death of Aurangzeb declined the Mughal Empire. Because there was no competent ruler, to succeed Aurangzeb. In a true sense. So we see it was Farrukh Siyar who succeeded him. So we see after Aurangzeb's death, it was FAR. We see that it was Farrukh Siyar who granted concessions, okay, who granted trade concessions to the company, trade concessions to East India Company, okay, in the year 1707. So we see that step by step, the British are able to control the, okay, mindset. They are being able to influence the mindset of the rulers of the different parts of the country, and they are able to secure, trading rights for themselves, at times duty free, at times trade concessions, okay, and they are also getting the zamindari rights. And with this, authority over the territories of the, so we see that they are coming as traders, but with passes of time, okay, they are moving towards gaining more and more, acquiring more and more territories of the subcontinent. Why they are doing so? Okay, they are doing so so that they are able to finance all their expenses, the expenses like military expenses, okay, and the administrative expenses. So they saw that there was political instability in the country, and they took advantage of this political instability, and they tried to, okay, establish themselves as the administrators with the passes of time. Okay, so this is the background, behind the, okay, the type of conflict that was taking place between the rulers and the, okay, the trading companies like the East India Company. We see that the East India Company, the main motive, the primary motive, of the East India Company was to earn what? Maximum profit. And how this could be done? The primary motive was to earn, okay, maximum profit. And they did so they tried to maximize their profit by buying cheap. Okay, from the cultivators, okay, buying cheap and selling dear. Okay, they bought at a cheap price. They forced the cultivators of our country to, okay, the traders, the cultivators to sell their goods at a cheaper price. Okay, they traded in goods like the goods purchased included what? The goods purchased included cotton, silk, spices, salt, okay, tea, indigo, saltpeter, etc. So these were the kind of goods. These were the kind of goods they were interested in. Okay, from the eastern countries, and they traded in these goods. There was a heavy demand. There was a heavy demand of these goods in the European market. Okay, so they pressurized the traders. Pressurized the sellers, the cultivators. Okay, to give up their goods at a low price. They purchased the goods at a cheaper price, and they took these. Took these goods to their native countries and they sold them at a higher price. Okay, and this is how they earned profit. As far as trade in Bengal was concerned, we see that there was there were certain areas of conflict. There were certain areas of conflict between the native rulers and the trading companies like the East India Company. Okay, so we see that this trade of goods. Now, supposing you want to buy cheap from me, but I am not ready to sell my good at a cheaper price. Now, what will arise? A conflict of opinion will arise. Okay, I will not like to sell my good to you. Okay, I would like to sell my good to a different buyer. And this is how the tension was created among the traders, among the rulers. Okay, and we will study about this under the next head, that is, okay, how trade led to battles. We see that at this time when the British were gaining control over the trade market, okay, we see, okay, Bengal was ruled by a number of rulers like Murshid Kuli Khan, Shujauddin, Aliwardi Khan, and so on. Okay, so we see that Bengal was ruled by a number of rulers like Murshid Kuli Khan, okay, and Shujauddin and Aliwardi Khan.